So Marcos, I'm a fan of the movie. I just watched it again recently. And so what about it came to you in terms of either just a straight adaptation or what the kernel of it that was interesting for you to put it into this format?
I'm going to let you ask Kevin that question because he brought that to me. It's one of his favorite movies. When we started talking about it, I instantly fell in love with what he wanted to mine out of the movie to make into a series, because it's not an obvious television series. And we can get into how we're making it that. But it's really, it came out of Kevin's love for the movie. He still doesn't believe me, but I have not watched the movie on purpose.
Okay.
I read the book.
Yeah.
I just felt I'm going to have to execute, and I just didn't want to have the thing in my head of how it was blocked or, you know. I did watch the trailer. I was on YouTube, and I have to see it, but I just didn't want to watch the whole movie. You can ask him that question. He's a huge fan.
Then follow up with that. Then how do you turn it into a series? So we can ask you.
This is, it's funny because some of this stuff is me talking for Kevin. It's all the things he pitched to me. But what the series is, when HG pursues Jack into present day, the series is really about the adventures that HG Wells goes on, not just pursuing Jack the Ripper, but in present day, the adventures he goes on and how those adventures informed his novels. Mm-hmm. So season one, for example, would be The Island of Dr. Moreau. The inspiration for that novel came out of the things he's going to experience in present-day New York because he came to pursue Jack the Ripper. What are the events that inspired The Invisible Man, or what are the events that inspired War of the Worlds? You know, he's considered the father of science fiction, and a lot of what he wrote about was ahead of his time. So the idea is that maybe he was ahead of his time. Maybe he got these ideas by actually experiencing things, and then went back and wrote these novels. So you then are able to mine seasons and seasons of material, because he's so prolific as a writer. That's what the series is.
Is Jack the Ripper an ongoing element?
He is, and I think what Kevin does really well, when you look at the mythology and the Vampire Diaries or even The Following, he's able to sort of take something that looks like, well, once you catch him, it's over. Or once, Kevin figured out a way to fold the John Stevenson Jack the Ripper story into the mythology so that it has it's a part of the fabric of the story. It's not just a single chase. I hope that makes sense. It makes sense to me.
Freddie, what did you read or watch in order to get ready for it?
I've read The Time Machine, The Island of Dr. Moreau, and I'm almost done with The Invisible Man. It's also just pure joy. It's so much fun to read. I'd seen the movie as well. And then just kind of working with our interpretation. I mean, what I've said is that I've noticed that we've taken that I feel does come from H.G. Wells is his obsession with utopia, which I think he did have, and there's that really is definitely what we have in this, is an H.G. Wells who really believes the best, and he thinks that science and technology will help us become a better race. So that's why he is profoundly disappointed when he comes to modern day and sees everything that he sees.
How do you view him? What's your view of that?
I see him as very wide-eyed. There have been moments where I feel like, oh, he's a little too wide-eyed, because he gives John Stevenson these chances. And he expects John Stevenson, when he catches him, to just be like, all right, come on, we're going back now. But, you see, he's a killer, he's not coming back, but that's how much he believes that John Stevenson will change his ways and be a good person. So he really, really does believe that humans have this innate ability to be just full of love. And that's what I think he seeks out in everyone.
Well, as the season goes along, are we going to see HG's sort of wide-eyed innocence? See him become a little bit more jaded, being in this today's world?
Absolutely. And again, I think you can sort of point to the work Kevin Williamson's done in the past, and you've seen that in characters he's created. That's what's going to make it fun, is to see the journey that he goes on and how it changes him. And does it make him a better man? Does it make him a worse person? how do you fight against it? So that's a big part of it. And at its core, there's this love story. You know, there's a love triangle in there. He comes to present day, he meets Jane Walker, played by Genesis Rodriguez, and they are immediately sort of put together through situations that sort of are unfortunate for her, but she needs him in her life, and he needs her to navigate modern day. And then how do we fold Jack the Ripper into that? Eventually, you know, he'll be part of that threesome.
Does the story take place both in the past and in the present, or is it just the one-time thing and then he's launched into the present?
It's not going to be every episode where we're time traveling. There'll be a few decades where we'll be going, but it won't be the centerpiece of the show. It's a tool to help us tell a story.
Yeah, the journeys he goes on are really to go and fix or try and fix something that he realizes have profound consequences in the current world. So if it's John Stevenson really wants the key to the time machine, because the key is the thing that allows you to travel and keep the machine with you. So there's that drive. And eventually, you know, in any good story, the bad guy will get it and will try and get away, and that's going to launch us into some period, but then we come back. And it's HG in that period trying to prevent John from causing any harm and changing history. So we do play with the, I think, the conventions of time travel shows, but we're only doing it a few times an episode, a few times a season, because we're not, time travel isn't what the show is about. It's about these men, these characters, and they're just using it for the adventure.
I'm going back to what you were talking about before about his optimism and thinks that he's going to just hand himself, you know, himself be arrested and all. Will you ever get those moments of victory, though, that your optimism actually pays off about something, rather than being the brunt of the jokes that they're saying, oh, I believe, and of course you get, you know, pickpocketed or something, you know?
I hope so, yeah. I mean, we've shot the first episodes. I'm not sure what's in store for some of the others, but there'll be that constant battle where I think John Stevenson is always going to, like, he's going to be saying, see, look at that, and he's going to keep this, they're constantly playing this chess game with each other, and hopefully there'll be a few times where he can prove.
Be. In any good chess match, I think we have to give HG the ability to outmaneuver John, and there will be, you know, they're going to one-up each other.
Yeah, and I think maybe to a certain extent, the love, at least in the first episode with Jane, is that she showed compassion, he has compassion, and for the first time he outsmarted Jack the Ripper by using the time machine to get to find out where he was, and that was an example of using someone through love and not through just going around killing people. So yeah.
How easy is it for him as a time traveler to actually talk to modern day people, understand what's going on, and understand this world?
I mean that's an element I love about the show, because I think there's lots of room for comedy there. Just understanding technology, miscommunication, all that sort of stuff, and there's a lot of room for that. I think we find, it's definitely from the first episode, that John Stevenson is much, he goes straight into this world and he starts talking to people fine, he gets changed, he's understanding technology, and HG is definitely stumbling, trying to figure it all out. But yeah, so a little bit of communication, but he's doing all right considering he's in New York and everyone has accents, and I'm sure he hasn't heard many, but you know.
It's a little bit like, you know, if you travel to a country where you don't speak the language, smart ones sort of listen and pay attention and try to adapt, right? And then there are people who are just like bulls in a china shop and don't pay attention to the fact that everyone else is speaking another language. And I think HG is considerate, and he's trying to figure it out, but he's watching, he's learning, and John's a little bit more bullish with it.
Are you trying to kind of build a circle around him? Because obviously you have Jane, but you're going to need a little bit more of a support base. How does that expand, and who are some of the supporting characters that will either help him on his early journey, or that you find are helping, you know, flesh out characters?
Now, have you seen the pilot? No. Yeah, so at the end of the pilot, there's a big twist.
Right, yeah, I have seen that.
When, and that's Vanessa Anders.
Yeah.
And when she says I don't know what's in the trailer. I forget.
It's in the trailer.
Yeah. I know, but what, is it when she says, this is how do you know, and she says, because you told me?
Yeah, right.
So we're going to learn that he's... This is one of the surprises. He's already time traveled. It's just that in this current timeline, he doesn't know that. She has information that he gave to her.
Okay.
And he said, this is going to happen on this day. You need to be there to come and get it so that we can stop this thing from happening. There's obvious questions that we answer, and I don't want to give it away, but if you're watching it, you go, why didn't he just tell her to get there before he took it? And there's a reason for that, because we discover whether it's that, oh, they did try that, and it failed miserably, and they realized the best way to do it is to let this happen, and that's the beauty of time travel shows, right? And because we're living in present day, we can sort of play out the drama and then discover that there was a wrinkle or something that has to be fixed, and then maybe go back and fix it. But we will build a circle around him with Vanessa Anders, his great-grandmother, who's a billionaire and has access to everything you could ever want, which makes it fun for us to play with, and Jane, of course. And then, and this is what I was saying earlier, the fabric of John Stevenson in our mythology is, or him fitting into the fabric of the mythology, is that the characters who we'll discover might be bad in the show, because there's somebody out there who also wants a time machine, and how do they know about it? Who are they? And does John, has he had contact with them? And, you know, those are part of the twists and the turns.
Is John big enough to have his own B stories? I mean, is he going to kind of run
huge,
parallel?
Okay, huge, all right. B story. Yeah, it's absolutely. I mean, it is very much a three-hander.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, you brought up that the seasons, I guess, are going to inform how he came up with the novels. They're given the adventures.
Yeah, the inspiration.
But how serialized is the season? Is it like completely serialized?
Completely serialized.
Oh, good. Yeah.
Not next season is a new thing. It's in the vein of what we've done on the following. You know, season two ended, season one ended, and season two continues the story. If it continued it a year later or whatever, it still picks up, it's serialized.
Cool. No, I'm thinking, I was like, I don't even want to know what you're doing.
That's it. I've never seen a bunch of choir before.
Don't worry, I have questions. I always have questions. You know, how hard was the casting of both those roles? Well, the three of those, but really the two.
It was hard. I think we got really lucky. Sorry to keep repeating this. You know, again, everyone I talked to about the film would talk about Malcolm McDowell and his and how amazing he was in it, and he's sort of how do you follow that? Or if you're going to redo something, that must be, it's a big challenge for an actor. I love that Freddie, I don't think we ever talked about it, and he never said, I have to live up to this thing, you know. But I was a little worried because I heard so many people talking about the performance. And I had seen Freddie on Unreal. I then looked at the other work he'd been in, and we just asked him to come in and read, and he hit it out of the park the first time. And we asked him to come back, and I think each time you make a little adjustment to see what if we went this way with him, or what if we went that way with him. And he's fantastic, really good. If you haven't seen it, I can say that we tested it. His character tested better than any male lead on any show I've ever worked with, and I think almost as high as the highest Warner Brothers has ever tested for a male lead. And with Genesis and John, it just clicked. You know, Genesis, a lot of people have been pursuing her for television, and she keeps saying no, she wanted the right project, and I feel like we got lucky that she really took to this. Josh is just hot. So I've been told. He's not here, so I'm not going to, you know, talk about him.
Well, Freddie, you said you did watch the movie, so you were well aware of Malcolm's portrayal, and so obviously you're going to try to dial in, not have that stuck in your head, and figure out who the character is for you. So, you know, how do you not let that sink into your head and weigh?
It's very, I mean, just knowing that it's from 79, it was just a very different type of different genre. And so I knew that whatever I'm bringing, I could see what I liked, what he did, and then stuff that he did that I was like, that's not going to translate. So I can just get an essence of what I thought he did, and then just know that we're doing something quite different. And I think TV and cinema has changed a lot since then. It's very grounded now, and it gets to, you know, obscene realism. So just trying to find that level of bringing it down a little more without losing the theatrics.
What was the note I kept giving you?
Every scene we did, he's like, bigger, bigger, you need to go bigger.
I hadn't seen the movie, but I felt that tonally I wanted to have some fun. I wanted some levity in it. And I think he's not saying this, but maybe because he was so informed by the performance of Malcolm McDowell that was kind of broad, he kept wanting to bring it down. And I kept pushing him in the other direction.
He's like, hey, big. And that's something I often get. It's like, just go for it more. And that's
it translates. It worked really well.